Sure. The next in our three-part series of webinars on using Storyboard Pro. Today we're going to be focusing on storyboarding for live-action productions. For those of you who aren't familiar, I actually board just about everything, but by far the bulk of what I do is live-action. So I'll be showing you a number of samples and going over some of the differences between that and animation and some specifics, since I know most people using the Toon Boom products are in animation. And a lot of people also want to try live action, so I'm going to go over a number of little tips and tricks to help you make that transition as well. I figured we'd start with just a little bit of information here and a little background on me. I've actually been working with Storyboard Pro since the beginning. They came to my studio and presented to me way back when. I don't even remember how many years ago. And I flipped the moment I saw it. I mean, I'm an old board artist. I started on paper. Like most people, then I started getting into doing some in Photoshop, which I really enjoyed, but there was a lot of limitations on using the other softwares because they don't work in a production environment very well. So when I saw what Storyboard Pro could do, even in the earlier versions, I freaked out over it. So I've been working very heavily with them and their team to make sure that it works as strongly as possible with our industry and supports everything that we want to do, and they've just done an amazing job. So it's very cool. I'm very excited. As you'll see, I'll probably pick up the pace as I go because I love showcasing this stuff. I wanted to give you a quick little a little bit of information just on my background, just so you know a little bit about where I come from and all this. I've been in the industry now for almost 30 years. I started as an art director. This shot there on the left is, that's me without the sleeves on. This is actually at Roger Corman's studio. That's where I got started. This is a movie I art directed called Slave Girls from Beyond Infinity. Yes, that classic midnight movie. Actually, it is pretty cool. If you haven't seen it, you definitely should. So I've designed everything from TV series to commercials, music videos. That's an industrial on the left. I designed for the Jetstream oven, which I actually had three of those freaking things from the shoot, which I loved. I'm also a syndicated cartoonist. I've got a strip called Hollyweird, which makes fun of everything in Hollywood. So everyone I work with kind of wonders where they're going to show up. A number of you may be familiar with some of the books I've written. For instance, the Storyboard book you see here in the middle. It's the main book that's used around the world. I think we're in 6 or 7 languages now. The third edition has got just about everything in the world you would ever want to know. Both the art of working in and the business of storyboarding. I saw a couple of questions that came in. That were specific. If we have time, I'll answer them on the business of storyboarding. Of course, Your Resume Sucks, my producing animation book. Even more people know these. These are actually my best-selling books. Facial Expressions. These are visual references for artists. So I took each book has got 50 models photographed from all different angles holding a variety of expressions. So if you're tired of looking at your own face in the mirror, this book is for you, or all of them. I'm also a 2-time national champion in Taekwondo. I'm a 2nd-degree black belt. I actually don't practice in it like I used to because my kids moved into a different sport. I was doing it with them. But that was a lot of fun, and I'm very loud with it. And then I got into being a story artist probably, I guess, around 20 years ago, a little over 20 years ago. I started into story late 80s. God, it's been longer. It's been longer than I thought, ladies and gentlemen. Anyway, so this is here on the left. I was storyboarding and I was the animation producer on Tooth Fairy 2, Larry the Cable Guy. That's the director, Alex Zamm, and I working over some scenes and shots using my handy dandy action figures like Spider-Man there, which is so poseable, to help lay out some shots. And there's Larry, which is a real treat to see Larry in a pink tutu, I gotta tell you. And I've also done a lot of directing and producing, both of live action and animation. This was from Spielberg's show, Sequest. I was one of the second unit directors on that show. So at this point, I've worked on over 4,000 productions. Obviously, most of them are commercials because we can do so many. I was just looking at earlier today. In the last 2.5 weeks, I've done over 3 dozen commercials. And that's not even including the pilot that I'm starting right now and the other animated pilot that I'm directing that we're in. Finalizing the last few shots right now. So we tend to stay really busy here at my studio. And just some of the projects that I've done boards on. Some of these I was also a producer. In fact, both of these I did boards and I was the animation producer on. Tooth Fairy 2 and the latest Little Rascals. The Water Boy, I did a lot of stuff on that, but my claim to fame is I actually designed the tattoo of Roy Orbison that's on Henry Winkler's ass. So next time you watch it and you see his butt, hey, think of me. Some of the more recent things, Magic City, Your Next. In fact, one of the great things about Your Next, besides the fact that it's a really fun horror movie, it's an example of how using the Storyboard Pro software is really fantastic for working long distance. I actually never went to the production site. They were shooting in Missouri. I stayed here at my studio in Florida. And just using Skype, I was able to work with the director and the producer like I was sitting right next to him. I just shared my screen as I was drawing digitally. And anything that time they needed to change, it happened real time in front of them. It saved them money. I got to stay home with my kids. It was just fantastic. So there's a lot of benefits for using the software. Then Dragon Tales and Guts. I was the creative consultant on the first 80-some-odd episodes of Dragon Tales. And then Guts, I was actually the second designer at Nickelodeon when National opened up in Orlando. And Guts is just one of the shows that a lot of people recognize. I was one of the original designers of the Aggro Crag, for those of you who are young enough to remember that. And then I got into pitching and selling a lot of my own shows. I landed somewhere over 30 deals now. And some of that obviously came from Nickelodeon. And that's a shot of me on the right, actually live in a pitch at Chorus. And my wife and I started another company helping people with how to package and pitch their ideas. And I do a lot of public speaking. Some of you may have been in some of these. The one on the left is I traveled through China a couple times giving some talks. On the right is the Ottawa International Film Festival. And that was actually doing a Storyboard Pro demonstration there. And I do a lot of training. This is from a studio in Mexico where I trained all of their studio artists on using this software. I did the same thing with Digital Domain. And I'm also the ugliest cheerleader you'll ever see. I know, your eyes are bleeding. I just thought it was funny to put up. And then I started, back in 96, my studio, Animatics Storyboards. Now we exclusively use the Storyboard Pro software on all the projects we work on. Then my animation studio, we do a lot of development and design, short form animation, it's clips here from a music video that we recently produced. And then the consulting company I was talking about, in fact, this is a great shot too, because the guy in the middle holding his chin, one of the taller guy holding his chin, is the president of Breakthrough Entertainment, Nat Abraham. And at that event, he actually made a deal with my clients, two guys up in the top left. So it's very cool when it works. And then I was telling some of you who were on earlier, if you want more details on using the software, I'm going to cover a lot of stuff here, but in an hour, there's only so much we can cover. I've got over 60 videos on lynda.com on all the specific details and showing you every button to hit and exactly what to do in this. So if you just go to lynda.com/Mark Simon, you can get access to the course. There are 8 videos out there that are free for anyone to watch. And if you are either in a school that has access or you pay the monthly fee, then you can see anything on Lynda, including all of my videos. All right, so that said, now, the system, a lot of people always ask me, what do I use when I'm drawing? Well, the Wacom Cintiqs are by far the best to use. There are some less expensive alternatives. A lot of them work well anyway, but nothing is as good as the Cintiq. I know the Microsoft Surface is actually pretty good. I've tried that out, and I like it. I just prefer the Cintiq. In fact, this is the Companion 2 that I'm working on. It's the same size as the 13 HD, which plugs into your laptop or your computer, except the Companion here is actually a Windows 8 or now a Windows 10 computer. So it's an all-in-one, and it's got about a 5-hour battery life. So when I get on a flight and I fly from here to LA, I can actually be working the entire time. It's really fantastic. It's huge resolution, too. It's much higher than high def. So I use that most of the time, and of course I also have my bigger Cintiq, and that's the 22 HD. It's the touch version, which is fantastic for higher end illustration. That's actually, I'm doing the demo here using the bigger one, although I prefer storyboarding on the smaller one, believe it or not, because I'm faster, because storyboards do not need to be really highly detailed art. We're telling a story. And I actually want to get through it quicker, so the smaller and sketchier is actually better for production for me. All right, so That said, let me switch over screens here. And there we go. So you should be seeing Storyboard Pro. And we'll get into this. Now, one thing I do want to mention is that I'm going to be focusing on a lot of the really cool aspects of the software that will help you work faster. I'm not going to spend time going through every detail on every aspect. I just want you to understand what's possible, because through the how-to, the help, or the Linda videos that I've done, that'll help you on the specifics. So I want to show you really quickly here one of the, this is an animatic that I created. This is actually for Brett Favre piece. You've probably seen this on TV. It's called Well-Groomed Man. It's for this shaving product, which I actually ended up buying. I liked the commercial so much, I actually bought my own product. So let me show this to you. It might jump a little bit for those of you streaming, but in the replay, obviously, it'll be perfectly smooth. The finished piece looked almost exactly like this. It's amazing how tight the edit was to it. So as you'll see here, I've got camera moves, I've got layer moves, and all of it's virtually real time as you're drawing. You know, I hear a lot of people say, oh, but I can do that already. Not like you can in this software, you can't. You know, any edit I do, all I do is hit play. I don't have to jump between programs. There's really no comparison on how quickly you can work in this software. So, you know, it's just an amazing piece. So let's get into some of the specifics. And one of the questions that I've been getting is, what are some of the differences between animation and live action? Like I said, you know, a lot of you are transitioning or want to transition from animation into live action or add it on to your repertoire. So one of the things that I like about live action is the style doesn't really matter, with the exception that when you're working live action, the directors do not want to see cartoony boards. So if you're used to drawing animation, create more of a realistic style, because they don't want to see cartoons. That's it. That's really the only thing. But it doesn't really need to look like the characters. It doesn't need to look perfectly realistic. You know, this is a good example here of a live action board. This is one I did last week for Tires Plus. I did 20 some odd commercials just for Tires Plus over the last couple of weeks. So that's probably one of the biggest things, because when you're in animation, in 2D animation, you've got to draw on model. All your characters need to look like the illustrated characters, especially if you're doing the cleanup. Live action doesn't matter. CG, it really doesn't even matter that much. Just 2D. But live action, you know, multiple styles. Some people draw tighter than others. And I see, Philip, you're on with us now, right?
Yes, I am.
All right. So I know
if anybody has questions during the demo, we'll try to save the ones till the end of the demo, unless they are pertinent to what Mark is doing at the time.
All right, you want to just introduce yourself real quick?
Oh, and yes, hi there, everybody. I already see some people like Don Evelyn that I know, and some others, so welcome. And I'm Philip Greenstein. I'm Senior Director of Sales for North America here at Toon Boom. So I've worked with Mark for years and years now, and I love working with Mark. He's so talented, as you can all see. So thank you very much, and sorry for being late, and let's just move on with the presentation.
Cool. Well, thanks a lot, Philip. And yeah, in fact, I think you and I were the first, you were my first person at Toon Boom to talk to, and I think vice versa for me is with you as well.
Yeah, well, no, I read your book, and I was like, I got to talk to this guy. So yeah, that was exactly how it happened. Somebody gave me your book. Then I was even lucky enough to have you sign it and do a little doodle in it as well. And it's something that I prize to this day.
Cool. That's awesome. All right. So one of the other big differences between live action and animation is, as I'm going through, you see, it's just most of these, it's just one drawing per scene. There's not a whole lot of action that happens in these. In animation, you're drawing many, many, many panels per action per scene. Live action, that's not the case. You don't need to tell the actors how to act, so we don't show them every expression. We want to have, you know, be somewhat expressive, and you know, if someone's smiling, but I don't need to show exactly what the motion of the hands are or if they're moving 6 inches closer to each other. In live action, it's setting up the shots and showing the big actions. If there's a big movement, yes, we want to see the beginning and end. You know, so for instance, this shot here, looking over one guy's shoulder at another guy, and they both turn in the exit frame. Or like this one where guy's running out of his office, and then he gets hung up by his headphones on his head. I don't need to do more than that in live action. So it's going to be a lot quicker getting through it. So for those of you who want to draw a little bit less, well, live action is very helpful there as well. Another big thing that's really handy is, well, it's more than handy. It's pretty important. You really do need to understand production when you're working live action boards. You do need to know directing terms. You need to understand how effects are done. You need to know, have somewhat of an understanding of stunts, because you're going to be working with the effects team. You're going to be working with the stunt coordinators. And when directors are telling you things, you do need to understand. I'm going to get into a couple of specifics here in just a minute on what I mean, and particularly like with the term pan, because that's totally misused most of the time. The other thing, there's a couple different types of boards that we do. We call this presentation boards, all right? So it's really tight artwork. It's often in color. You know, these are agents. We also call them agency boards. So this is when I'm working with an agency, and we're just trying to get a feel for what the spot is going to say and what's going to happen. But it's not every shot, okay? Or in animation, you always say it's a scene every time there's a cut. We don't we label it differently in live action. It's different shots within scenes. And I'm going to get into that in just a moment as well. But so, for instance, here's three different shots just to kind of get a feel for how we're going to be showcasing the product that the agency for Black & Decker will approve or not approve to move forward. So, and these are separate. And often I'll actually do, or our studio will do, these types of agency boards. And then when it gets approved, they go into production. And we might do 5 or 6 or 10 of these. One or two will be chosen for production. And then when the production comes on board, production company, they'll then hire us to then do the production boards. And the production boards look more like this. Here, I'll zoom in a little bit. This is actually from the Tooth Fairy 2 movie. And you can see these are really rough. There was a very, very tight turnaround on how much time we had. So these are my thumbnails, and never went beyond thumbnail on most of the scenes and sequences on this movie. Didn't need any more than that. Again, we're just kind of showcasing exactly what was going to be happening. And I was able to just pump out a huge amount, 100 plus panels a day. And that includes getting the notes with the director. So I don't usually erase or delete a layer of the roughs that I'm laying down. I'm literally just running as quick as I can with it. And again, all this is done in Storyboard Pro. So that's a difference between presentation and production boards. We also call production boards shooting boards. Okay, so numbering. I want to talk just briefly about numbering. So these being that this is live action, there's two different places where you're going to see the numbering in Storyboard Pro. One is under panel, act, scene, shot, and panel. We don't often use the act, the acts in this. I did here just to differentiate between multiple commercials that I put into one presentation for you. But a scene is everything that happens in one location at one point in time. And then you have different camera angles within that, and every different camera angle is a different shot. So you could have 20 shots within one scene. See, the difference there is with animation, every time there's a new change in camera, it's considered a new scene. You don't have shots, you just have scenes. Here we have scenes, shots, and then panels are how many drawings does it take to showcase the action that's happening in that one shot. Okay. The other place you'll see is if you look down here in the lower left, that's on the timeline. I like working on the timeline. You have lots of different ways of seeing your screen as you're working in Storyboard Pro. This is one I always work in. Not some of the time, it's all of the time. So they've got different preset workspaces. You know, here's one where you just see the larger thumbnails, but it's not a timeline across the bottom. And then sometimes when I'm working with the director, I'll pop this one up, which just allows us to see all the panels together, and I can just click and drag and reorder things in this, which is a really nice way of looking at it. Or if you want to see it kind of the way it's going to look in PDF. In live action, we export in PDF with the panels vertically, whereas in animation, for those of you who work in animation, you know it's always horizontal. And so as you're working in animation, you can see it that way as well. Let me just pop that up, where you have three or four panels across. So it just a glance, you can see it any way you want. But I always like working in the timeline, because even if I'm not being hired to do animatics, I'm always creating at least rough animatics, because that's how I can tell if my story is flowing properly. And that's one of the things that you get to do in Storyboard Pro that you don't get in any other software, is real time. I can look at it and listen to it, because I have unlimited layers of audio that I can add into this. And I'll show you samples of that in just a minute too. But I can really hit play at any point and just see and hear, is it working? Am I staying on a shot too long? Am I getting bored? Am I crossing a line of action? I didn't realize it. All those types of things you can only see in action as things are moving. Or if I have a camera move, you know, how does that work? How is it really, you know, is that helping me tell the story? This software allows me to tell a story better. And that's one of the things I just absolutely love about it. Here's something that is really cool. So let's say that I'm talking to the director. So here I've got scene 15 and then scene 16. So I start on a wider shot, and then there's a close-up of the guy. Well, the director could say, you know what? You know, let's change that. So can we have the 16 first? Sure. So just that quick, I just moved it over. It's done. Now, it stayed. It renumbered it slightly for me. Well, I can just come through here now, and I can go storyboard, and I'm going to rename my scenes. I can rename shots or scenes. All right, I don't want it to be 15. I want it to just be 15, and I'm going to hit to renumber all of them. And look, here it'll tell you exactly how it's going to renumber it all the way through. Boom. And if I do a lot of changes, your numbers could be all over the place. Well, that quickly, I just renamed every scene through the entire thing. Now, for those of you working in Photoshop, or in Sketchbook Pro, or on paper, and you've got some changes, and you need to go through and renumber, you know what a pain in the ass that is, and how long it takes. I don't know about you. I don't want to be doing that. I want to be drawing. I want to be telling stories. So the idea of having to go through and renumber things appalls me. I mean, there's just no way I would ever go back to doing it that way again. So, you know, this is just the most amazing way of working. So it's literally click and drag, and I hit play, and I can see it, everything as I'm going. So I want to talk about pans. Pan, for those of you who work in animation, means any camera move. Whether it's up or down or moving around, it's always considered a pan. Well, that's not true in live action at all. A pan is a very specific thing. So let me show you an example here. I'll just add on to this. So I'm going to add a new scene. I'm just going to click down. It's going to add a new scene for me. And I actually have some drawings saved in my library from another project that shows a pan. So someone had sent in a question asking, what if you like to draw in another program? Can you then bring in the artwork into Storyboard Pro? Absolutely you can. And here's an example of how easy it is. So I just literally went into my library. And all library is just a folder that has a collection of photos, audio, other drawings, any number of things, and you can literally just drag them into your project. So, all right, so I'm going to add another panel in the same scene. So notice there's a solid bar, so it's all in the same scene, and the gray above these two panels shows that those are in the same shot. Here's the other drawing for it. Drag it in. I'm done. So pan in live action means that the camera is stationary. Okay, the camera doesn't move, it pivots. So as the car drives by, the camera pivots with it. So as it's in front of us and starts going by, we're looking at the front of it, and as it passes us, we look at the rear bumper, okay? That's a pan. Now, that's not the same thing as a tracking shot. So a tracking shot, let me go into Act 4, Scene 17. Here we go. Okay. Oh, here. All right, so this is a tracking shot. So the difference here is the camera is actually moving across the hallway. It's just a slight truck. We call it tracking or trucking or dolly move. There's a number of different titles for actually moving the camera. If it's going way up high in the air, we'll call it booming up, or a crane shot. But this is a pan, and it's only the camera moving left or right. If the camera is pushing in, it's called dolling or trucking in. So you really do need to understand the difference, because if someone says they want to pan and you're used to animation and you do any type of move, that's not the case. Or if they want a certain thing and you call it a pan, you don't want to use the wrong terminology. It's a very simple thing, but it's very important. Yeah.
Sorry, Sharan has a question about panning. So she's asking, so a pan is like moving your head from left to right, but not moving your body.
Correct. That's a great way of looking at it. Yep. Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for helping me clarify that. So obviously, and doing a pan is so easy. Actually, doing any kind of camera move in Storyboard Pro is so freaking easy. In fact, let me go to, this looks like a good shot to play with. This is another one from Tyrus Plus. So I can actually just come over here to my camera icon, and I'm going to go to my tool properties, and I'm going to put two keyframes. So they give me, I can put a keyframe anywhere, but in this case, I just put a keyframe in the beginning and the end automatically onto this panel. The nice thing, though, is if you look down here on the timeline, I can extend. Here, let me just duplicate this. There it goes. So I can have a camera move go over over multiple panels in the same shot. So it's not just over one piece of art. I can have one single camera move going over multiple pieces. So to give you an example, let me go ahead and I'm just going to turn off the people on this one just so you see the difference between this panel and this panel. Okay. So what I'm going to do is green means beginning. So I'm going to move the camera over here. In fact, let's zoom in. Let's zoom in on these kids over here. So we're going to start there. And then we're moving over and we're pulling out. So you see the artwork changes, but it's one steady camera move. So that quickly, I could do a zoom, I could do a pan, I can actually rotate. So at the beginning, now it's rotate, so now it's twisting as I pull out. So I can do any number of things with the camera, and I can put different keyframes in there. I can also just grab, so you see this blue line right here. Whoops, let me go back to camera. This blue line right here, that's my camera path. Well, I can also put a curve in that camera path just by grabbing it and moving it just that easily. So now you've got a really cool, funky move. And it's so fast. So as I'm working, I can literally just come in and then I hit play and everything starts playing and I can see my animatic real time as I'm going. You know, one of the things that if you're used to working in Photoshop and going into After Effects and going into Premiere, you know, it's about 10 steps, especially if you start in paper, in order to see anything that happens. So, you know, if you've got everything edited together, you need to do a change. You know, if you're working on paper, you've got to make the change, scan it, put it into Photoshop. If you're working in Photoshop, you make the change in Photoshop. You export, you edit out the layers, you export that out, you bring it into After Effects, you do adjust the move, then you export out of After Effects, you go into Premiere or Final Cut, and then you can finally see what your change makes. Whereas in Storyboard Pro, I do all of that in one software. I never leave it. You've got an incredible master that anyone else, the directors and editors, can actually start working in this as well. So in Previz, you work it all out together with one master. It takes the place of so many different softwares and makes production so much easier. I've worked both ways because, again, I've worked on so many different productions. Working between softwares, I won't do anymore. And the first thing I do is I sit down with production and I show them the benefits. They get it instantly.
Mark, we've got a question from Brett. He's wondering when he's adding keyframes to the camera, then he goes to stretch a panel duration, the keyframes all stretch and timing changes. Is there a way to lock the camera?
Yeah, there is. You can set your keyframes where they follow on individual panels or on scenes or on the entire project. I normally don't do it, but like for instance here, if you see the keyframe stretches along with the panel, and it stays proportionally at the same spot. But I can set it, I can easily set it to where those keyframes would stay where they are. So as I'm working on the rest of it, they won't change. Same thing with audio. I can have the audio track to the actual panel that it's on. So I can change timings elsewhere and the audio still stays locked to that individual panel that I need it to be.
And how do you do that lock? Or how, can you show how you lock a panel?
As far as with the audio or with the camera?
With the camera.
Yeah, keyframe sync mode. So relative to, I can have no sync relative to the panels or relative to the shot. So it's literally that easy. Just go to camera and then how do you want to sync it up? It's so fast, guys. It's really great.
Thank you. That's great. Thanks, Mark.
So one of the other things I wanted to show you is I can also animate layers as well as the camera move, and doing the two together is just amazing. So here I've got a shot where I have everything drawn in different layers. So I've got the blue tone of the ocean here on one. I've got the what I call the ink layer, which is my background, and then I have the car. And this again, this is was a very specific car too. They wanted the Pontiac Aztec, so that's what I drew into it. Driving into frame on this shot. So if I want to see how that's going to look, I'm just going to minimize that down, and I'm using the touch. I'm actually doing pinch with my fingers, just like you do on your phone, which is really cool. So over here, I've got my layer transform. So as long as I have my layer selected, green is first layer, red is the first frame of the transform, red is last frame. So I want I'm going to set the last frame first, because that's actually, I kind of want it to end right where we see it here. So I'm going to set that there. I'm going to take this pivot point. I like having my pivot points right in the middle. So if I want to do a rotation, I can grab and I can rotate a layer around any way I want as well. And I can also set how many layers of undo. And I'm going to go and I'm going to do, all right, so at the beginning, though, I want this to be much bigger. I'm going to hold down the shift key and drag it out. So I'm going to want the car to start out of frame. It's got to be pretty big, so it's going to be closer to camera. So literally that fast, I just animated that layer. Again, all in one software. Now, let's say I actually want to do a camera move on this. So I want to start over on, maybe on this tent or more on the ocean. And here I do want to track over to the right. So I'm just going to come in here and I'm going to add a couple keyframes. And you know what? I'm actually going to want to be in a little bit tighter, both the beginning and the end. So let's move my beginning frame over to the edge and end frame more here. So as I'm going, so now as I'm tracking over, the car drives into frame. Make it a little bit bigger for you guys. This is what the camera actually sees. Okay? And again, all this is real time as I'm working. And if I want to hit play, you see that's the actual speed right there. Playback is virtually real time. Of course, that'll be somewhat dependent on your computer and how heavy the artwork is. A lot of photos, or if you're doing this vector or bitmap. I always draw in bitmap, which I'm going to show you guys the differences there in just a minute. One of the other things that when you're getting into production, the scene and shot numbers are really important. When you're just boarding it out, it doesn't mean as much as when it actually goes out to production. So, for instance, here I've got scene 6, shot 1, and shot 2, and then scene 7, 1, and then scene 8. So let's say I want to take scene 8, both shots 1 and 2, and I want to move it way up here. So, all right, I drug it up there, I moved it. If this has already gone out to production, they're already making plans that this is going to be scene 8. I can't change the numbering here, because if I change the numbering, when it goes down the pipeline, it's going to completely screw with every department, right? Because once this goes out to all the different areas of production, you can't change the numbering. Well, Storyboard Pro was smart about this. So I can actually come in here, and I can actually come in, and I can lock shot and panel numbers. So now I can't change it. So if I go to try to change it, it won't let me. Or if I go to add new shots, it's going to automatically add 15A, 15B, 15C automatically for me. I can always go back and unlock it if I did it at the wrong time and I shouldn't have done it, so I can just unlock that quickly. But this is a great way to help you help protect production once they go out, and if you still need to make changes, which often happens. I'm often on set with a director and they want to change things, but we can't change the scene number. So I just lock it so there's no chance I'll accidentally make change something that I shouldn't.
Got a question for you, Mark.
All right.
Can you delete the layer keyframes or modify them?
I can do both. So for instance, I can actually come in here and for camera, I can go under camera and I can just hit reset camera. It goes back to the default at the beginning. And then I still have complete access to change that and adjust it however I want. And then for the layer, make sure you've got the layer selected. As you can see right now, the car is moving in and out. I can go here to layer, and I can hit reset transform, because animating a layer, we call it transforming the layer. So there and it goes back to where it was in the beginning. Now, as you see, as I scrub, it doesn't move at all. So that's how quick it is to reset it. Now, you were also asking, I did undo to go back to it moving again. So that's the way it is right now. So I can just go through and let's say my end frame, I don't want it there, but I want him like he's about to plunge into the ocean. It's that fast. All right. It literally, as soon as you do it, it's there to work real time in the software. All right. So let's talk about pens. One of the things that artists, and including myself, when in some of the earlier versions, I'm going to add a new scene in between these here, a blank one. They were complaining about in the software was that it was all vector lines, and most people don't like drawing in vector lines. They're just kind of ugly. And when I mean a vector line, if you've ever worked in Flash. Okay, a vector line is very steady. It looks like perfect ink. The nice part is it's infinitely scalable. And just like in working in Flash or Illustrator, you know, it's got all the nodes in there. And I can, so if you want really tight artwork in here and you like working in vector, you know, you can adjust this in any way that you want. You can select multiple and just drag it around. Okay. I don't draw that way. I don't like the way it looks. I like drawing with something that really looks like a pencil. Okay, so I always work on bitmap layers, and you can select whether you're drawing on a bitmap or a vector layer. So Storyboard Pro now has these pencils that look like a pencil lead. I mean, I'll zoom in here. And the nice thing is it even gets darker as you go over it. And, you know, it's completely dependent here on how hard or soft I'm sketching. And they've got different ones. So, you know, a lot of times I'll do a fill with it. You know, if you don't like that kind of fill, you know, you could do this kind of fill. If you like a really solid fill, all right, so we can give you a really solid fill. So you've got a lot of different options here, but it just looks fantastic. I just love sketching where it feels like and looks like my pencil as I'm working. You know, and I'll just start doing my roughs. You know, okay, there goes my cartooning aspect again. You know, as I'm going, and it just feels right, and it's got the kind of look that you want. Now, the nice thing is, and all right, so that's on a bitmap layer, but what if I tried using a bitmap brush on a vector layer? Well, oh, that was a vector. Let me go back to bitmap brush. I could still use a bitmap brush on a vector layer. So you're not really that limited. The only differences are what you can actually do with that line when you're working. So, for instance, you know, if I select this vector line, I can adjust it. If I select that bitmap line, it's not going to have the same effect to it. So just know what you need to do going in, and you can pick your brushes. So they've got a lot of options. Now, one of the other things I want to show you guys is something that I have made a lot of use of, which is a very special brush that they call. Let me get to my brush icon here. Over here, I can add a new, I can make my own brushes, which is the first one there, icon. The second icon over here is called a dynamic brush. Now, a dynamic brush allows you to take vector illustrations and save them as a brush. And I've used it for crowds, I've used it for a lot of different things. But in this instance, I'm gonna do something I've done a number of different times, confetti. So, you know, sometimes, you know, and I'll just do one small area, and then, you know, so I'll do different colors of it. So I'm using a vector brush on a vector layer, right? You know, however I want the confetti to look, right? I'm going to select it with my selection tool, okay? So I've got all that selected. I'm going to go back to my brush tool. Under tool properties here, it shows up, and I'm going to select new texture brush. And that fast, it made me a new brush. So now I can just go through, and I can add confetti, and I can actually fill the screen. But here's the other thing. It's a brush, so I can scale it. So if I want to go back, I'm going to make that smaller. So now I've got smaller confetti for the background. If I want to do some confetti, it's up really close. So I can very quickly, so you could do anything, whether it's grasses or a person's face. If you're doing a thing with clones and you want to clone a face over and over, draw a face with a vector, capture it, use it as a dynamic brush, and paste it over and over. So you can do anything you want with it. I can even change the opacity, just like in Photoshop, of any brush. So it's just so cool on however you want to work. That was changing the opacity of that color. I didn't need to do that. Here we go. So I can totally adjust the opacity here as I'm working. So anyway, so those can save a huge amount of time. Now I want to show you a little bit about the library. You know, I showed you guys just a moment of that. I can open or close any library. Like I said, all it is I right-click, go open a library, and I find a folder that I want. In this case, I'm going to show you guys some audio. I'll usually do record my own scratch tracks when I'm working. It just helps me get a feel for the timing. It doesn't matter how good or bad of an actor I am. So let's say here I'm dialogue line 7 for Ned. So I can literally just take Ned's audio, and I'm going to drag it down into my audio line. I can move it wherever I want. I can adjust the audio levels, and I can scrub it, right? Or if I hit play, I'll hear it.
Jeff, you're a pillar of society. Go on.
And I can add as many layers of audio as I want. So I just added 4 or 5 layers, or tracks, as I guess we should call it. So you can lay in as many as you want. Now, one of the things that I always do, and this is just a tip for you guys, I always try to do my voices on the first 2 tracks. That way I can overlap audio as I need to, right? And then I do sound effects on tracks 3 and 4, and then I do music on 5 and 6. I can spread that out if I need more layers. Obviously, I can have as many as I want. I've had as many as 30. It all work fine. But the reason you want to do that is so it makes it easy to export. So if you just want to export the voices, just export tracks 1 and 2, and you get a voice track dialogue that's edited perfectly. Or if you want to turn off the sound effects for any reason or music, you just turn off those specific layers, and you know going in that it's going to work for you. So a little bit of pre-planning, which doesn't really take any time at all, as you can see, really makes it easy. If you want to turn off a layer, you literally just click on the little speaker icon on that track. You don't hear it anymore. And it's going to track along with whatever panel the first frame is attached to. So if I adjust that one, the scene before or the shot before, my audio is going to track perfectly with it. So, and anything I do afterwards, again, it's not going to affect at all. Yeah.
Mark, we have a question from Don about the file formats for sound, WAV, MP3, AIFF, anything else?
MP3 and Wave are the ones that we use. I haven't used much of AIFF, but you can. So, and I can lock audio tracks. There's so many different things I could do in here. But, yeah, the main audio, if it's what you're using, chances are it's going to work. So, but MP3, I like MP3 because it's smaller and it keeps the file size smaller. Waves are obviously a little bit better because they're not compressed. But for storyboarding, it's pre-vis. I don't worry about that.
And a question, just going back a little earlier, the dynamic brushes can be used with bitmap as well as vector, correct?
No, it's only vector. You can only create a dynamic brush with a vector line.
Okay, thanks for clearing that up.
Uh-huh. All right, so this is one way. In fact, this is another tip. Whenever I'm recording audio, I record them the lines of dialogue numerically, so 006, 007, 008. That way, as I'm going through, I don't have to search for them. I just know if I did. All right, this last one I put in here was 8, Melva. So I know the next one is going to be 9, Ned, that I'm going to bring in. Again, it just makes it so quick and easy for me to keep everything tracked, and I can then adjust the timing in between what they're saying just by clicking and dragging. Super fast, and I can even edit. So I can crop in. I can just grab the end of that audio line, and I can crop it in. Let's say I want to take... All right, so there's a little pause right here where Melva's talking. So if I want to split that, so that pause longer, I just go up here under sound and split clip at current frame. I cut it, and I could just edit that quickly and move things around. I mean, they make everything so quick and easy in here. Another way that I use, the library is for reference art. So for instance, let's see, where's a good one here? I think on scene 5 I had a good one. Oh, here we go. All right, so this car in the background, it's the Aztec, the Pontiac Aztec. Now, you know, I can draw anything from any angle, but cars are going to take me a while. You know, and in storyboarding, it's not like art school. There's no such thing as cheating. Whatever it takes to get there. I want to work fast, so I'm going to turn off the ink layer. I actually found a photo of the car from the angle that I wanted, and I use that to draw over. So, boom, I've got it. I turn off the car. It's done. No one I've ever worked for has ever said, wait a minute, did you trace that? We don't accept that. Well, that's bullshit. Of course they will. They just want it to look good. However you get there is up to you. And if I can say, that's a time-saving device. If I can save time and not have to worry about drawing a good car, it's a fraction of the time, which means I'm making more money and delivering to my client quicker. There's really no negative. But you can even take your own drawings. So going back to the library here, I'm going to go to my reference folder. So you can even see in the reference folder, you know, here's the different Aztecs that I found. And I literally went through, and I think it was actually this car that I found. So I brought in, wait a minute, but that's the wrong direction. So I just came in under tools, and I just flipped it, and then I just resized it. I mean, it was that quick and easy. And I placed it where I needed to. But one of the other things that's really cool is the ability to save your artwork or an entire shot. So for instance, on this panel here, I need to draw this tire wall. And because I was doing a series of these commercials, I knew that because they told me that we were going to redo or do versions of this over and over and over. So I don't know about you guys. I don't want to redraw all those tires every time. But I want them to look nice. I put some decent detail in it. Again, it's storyboard, so I wasn't going to make this a full-fledged illustration. There's a difference between boarding and illustrating. So once I drew it all out, you know, if I turn off the ink layer, here you see I've got, you know, just one layer here that has all the tires. Well, what I did was I dragged that layer over here, and I named it Tires TPL. CPL is just that's the automatic designation that Toon Boom gives it. But I called it tires, so I knew that now as I'm going into another scene, like here's another commercial. Oh, and there's those tires again, right? So turn that layer back on. All I need to do was take the tires. I'm going to turn that off. So I can just take my drawing and drag it in, and here's my tires. And I can resize them and put them anywhere in, and I don't have to redraw them. And then even, let's go find another one. All right, so let's say this. These are on one layer. Let me find one where I've got multiple layers drawn on. Here we go. Okay, so let's say this, if I know I'm going to use this over and over, I've got my lines on one layer, and I've got the tone, the gray tone, on another layer. What I can do is I can actually just click on the entire panel down here on the timeline, and I can drag the entire panel in. It's going to save the whole thing. It's loading it up right now. You'll see it build here in just a second. On the file sizes of everything are a little bit bigger when you're using bitmap rather than vector. Vector are smaller. I just like the look of bitmap. So I'm going to call this tire close up. Okay. Now it shows up over here in my library. So let's say if I'm down here and the director says, after this shot, let's do a close up. All right. So I'm going to do a new scene. And then I'm going to just grab what I'd drawn before, drag it in. All the layers I had done before, it's still in its layers, and I don't have to redraw it. So if I need to make an adjustment, I don't have to worry everything's flattened. It's not flattened. All the layers I originally drew are still there, so now I can make an adjustment quickly if I want to. All right. So this
Mark,
is cool.
Mark, yeah. Sorry, just a quick question, actually going back, just about renaming of sound layers, of panels for sound. Can you rename panels for sound or your different layers? I'm assuming the question is that the sound layers, each one can be renamed.
Well, what shows up over here in the library is whatever you have it named in your folder. So it's just a file name, and however you have it named in your file folders is exactly how it shows up.
Can you rename on the fly?
Right here, this is just accessing the folders. This actually isn't in the software.
Right, okay.
This is looking on your hard drive. So if you want to rename them, just go to the original file source and rename it.
And the other question being asked by Don is, can you adjust the tone of the drawing? As example, the shades used to enhance the drawing, like how you would adjust the levels in Photoshop.
No, you don't have levels that you can adjust. If I've drawn something really light and I want it darker, I'll just duplicate that line, I can fake it. But that's, for instance, here, if I want that layer, I'll just duplicate it. Actually, it didn't make it darker. It depends on if. That's right. That was a different. That was an import of a JPEG. Here, this is just a tone. If I duplicate this, that layer of gray tone, notice how it got darker if I have two layers of it. So I can fake it that way. But this is not Photoshop. This is not a program where you're going to go through and do your color adjustments and everything afterwards. Okay.
And by the way, that goes to an earlier question that somebody had about the difference between Photoshop and Storyboard Pro in terms of tools. And that, I think what you said there is very important. Photoshop is Photoshop, and the Storyboard Pro is Storyboard Pro. We're not trying to become Photoshop. We're trying to be the best storyboarding software available.
Yeah, because, look, storyboards are not illustration. You understand the difference. You know, this is quick drawing that supports production. We don't need to be doing color adjustments. You're generally never going to do color on a storyboard unless there's just some spot color anyway if you're doing production boards. These color examples like this, you know, these we did in Photoshop because I needed to have that kind of color control and gradients and things.
Exactly.
But if I needed to put these in Animatic, I just take the JPEG exports and I bring them into Storyboard Pro, and then I can manipulate and use it however I want. So.
And you may have covered this, Mark, but you know, for those who don't know, when you're importing a Photoshop file, you can import it flattened or in its Photoshop layers as
well.
Yeah,
the layers will import just like you see over here as well. Yeah, good point. No, I hadn't mentioned that.
Quick question also from Peter. This is more general in nature, but file size. He's asking whether you recommend exporting, let's say, out of Storyboard Pro and into Harmony, or, you know, that could really go for any other software, as bitmaps or as vectors, and especially, like, depending on the resolution, like if it was for a movie for an iPad, but I assume the answer to that.
If you're exporting for production, they don't care. It's only the actual Storyboard profile that's bigger or smaller. If I export out to PDF or to JPEG, the exports are going to be exactly the same size if you're using bitmap or vector. It's only the actual Storyboard Pro file itself that'll get bigger if you're working in bitmap. I've never cared. I don't care how big my file gets. Hard drive space is so cheap these days, it really doesn't matter. So I want my art to look good. So I use whatever brush I think looks better.
And this is my own continuation to that question. It's also probably useful for the audience. But if people have projects where the client is asking for, you know, media that could be shown on different devices with different screen sizes, how do you handle export from multiple resolutions?
I just give them a 2K file, just the high resolution HD file, and then they can show it on whatever they want. It's going to look
great.
The same. So.
Got a couple more questions for you before you continue. Can you just, how can you shade in Storyboard Pro from SRI?
Here, let's shade her butt. That sounds like a good idea. Let me go to, I usually use this marker that they've got. And so, what I'll often do, let me go to the tone layer underneath the line. So, I'll come in and, like anything, I usually, any kind of marker type of work, this will go under the line. Notice it looks like I drew over the line, but when I let go, it'll sink under it because the tone layer here is underneath the ink layer here. Using the same color as I keep working over it and over it, it'll keep getting darker. And then if I really want it to get a lot darker, I just grab a darker gray and I can just layer over that way. And if I want to add some, a highlight to it, even though it's set as marker, I can add highlight over on top. So it's additive unless you have the draw behind. Now the draw behind tool here, it's this line with a squiggle through it. Let me show you what that does. So if I'm drawing on the ink layer and I want to keep everything, I'm going to turn off that tone. And I want to keep everything on the ink layer. If I just have everything set normally and I have, let's just use this purple as an example, and I'm coloring this way, it's going to cover over the line. Notice it's in front of it. If I use the draw behind and I color it, The color drops back behind. No matter how dark my purple gets, it'll go behind the line. Okay, so that's helpful. Then, if I also want to take another color, and I'm drawing, and I can go over it, it's going to instantly drop back behind anything else. So I don't have to worry about coloring over my own artwork. And the nice thing about that is, and I don't do this often, but if you want to animate a layer, so let's just animate this. If I've done use the draw behind for my coloring and for my tone, and I animate the layer, it stays with it. So what'll happen is, here's tone. See all the gray in there? Since that's on a different layer, it didn't move with it. So if you're animating a layer and you need tone on it, use a draw behind so you keep everything on one layer. All right, so let me show you guys another one of my favorite aspects here, because this is becoming more and more common. On certain projects, you may have environments or vehicles or props that are built in 3D. So if you've got an FBX file, which most programs can export to FBX, you can actually take a 3D file, and all I have here is I have a library that opened up to where I save some of my FBX files, and I drag it in. Now, it's giving me a message here. A 3D layer was inserted. This shot will automatically be converted to 3D. Yep, that's good. I want it to be. So what this is going to do is it's going to bring in this gun. It's converting it, and it's converting my layer. All right. Now, I'm going to slightly minimize this. There we go. I had to grab that corner so that you can see. I'd already opened up two other windows, a top view and a side view here. So I'm going to zoom out on these just so I could see them a little bit better. So if you've ever worked in 3D, I can grab, this triangle is my camera view. So let me grab my camera icon. I can actually select my camera. I can move it here. Now, now obviously I don't see, if you look on the left, you can't see the camera because the gun, because the camera doesn't see it. So I can rotate it around until I do see it. And then the side view, I'm going to go up so I can see it more. So now if you look in the left-hand side over here in the drawing, this is actually what the camera would see. Now I can do some manipulation actually within here as well, but I can also manipulate the actual item. So as long as I've got my transform layer button selected, so I can rotate the gun around any direction that I want, and I can use a draw over, or I can just leave it in here. But at the same time, I can actually go into a layer. Let me grab my pen. And I can draw right onto a layer. So I've got a layer selected here, but it's not letting me draw. Why isn't it letting me draw? Well, the reason is because we're in 3D, you can only draw on the layer that's flat to camera. So under layer, if I go to align layer to camera, no, nothing really changed. It's invisible behind the scenes. But here, I can now, whoops, let me get a darker color. Okay, so I can figure out, all right, so let's say if I wanted the character's face right here. All right, so just real quickly, I can put in whatever I want. And now it's actually in there on a separate layer as the gun, but I'm able to draw on those layers. The thing is, that layer is also, I can manipulate it in 3D as well. So notice, because I'm in this whole scene is in 3D, I can move this around any way that I want. And I can scale it, and I can, you know, I can move it wherever I need. And it also shows up over here on the right. If we look at side view and top view, so I can move that element around. Why is it not moving? Oh, it's because I'm on the gun layer. So I can move it around on this layer using any of these other panels and manipulate it and move it wherever I need to go. So it's amazing what you can do. So looking at all that, let me show you guys this. All right, I'm going to expand this again. Okay, so here's a shot that I created. Let's see if I can get to a wide. Okay, so kind of an alleyway, the girl looking out her window, right? All of this are 2D hand-drawn layers, but I manipulated them in a 3D environment. So, adding a camera move, now you see on the right there, there's a wall that's perpendicular to the other ones, and it's all the same brick, I just duplicated it. So I'm moving the camera back, but you get that perspective change, coming around, and then push in past the girl to see that this monster is about to eat her, right? All of this in one great camera move, using 2D artwork. I can put 3D elements in here as well, but I've had to do this on a few different really cool tracking shots that production wants to work out, so I'll build it. And it's really fast and easy in Storyboard Pro to do this.
Mark, there was a question about tracing over a 3D object, and specifically the gun. There was asking if you could trace over the over the gun with a designated pencil.
Sure. Yeah, so what I'll probably do is I'll move the gun down to a lower layer here, and let me go ahead and just rotate it to a different angle so we can see a little bit more, okay? All right, so that looks good. And I'll turn that off, and so Go to a bitmap layer here. So what I'll do is I'll take the gun layer and I'll put it down below my other layers, and then I'll grab my pencil and the layer that I'm on. Again, I need to go to layer, align to camera, which allows me to draw. Grab the kind of pencil I want, like the 25 pixel in black. Okay, so now I'm going to come in. I'll just do this just real quick, just to kind of give an idea here. So it's not going to be the prettiest thing, but I'm just trying to give you guys an idea here. All right, then if I turn off the gun layer, all right, now I can come in and adjust it however I want. So, you know, and I can play with it, and it's just another drawing. So, again, it's a great reference. And I actually have a car that that I'm going to be doing the same things. I don't want the 3D car, but I want the reference of being able to move it into any angle that I want, and I'm going to do it just this way on one of my projects. So, hopefully that answers your question. Quick and easy. Okay. How are we doing on time?
Well, we're at 3:08 p.m. EST.
We've gone over an hour already.
By the way, Lila, I'm just going to answer Lila quickly. We support FBX, Alembic, and Collada file formats for 3D.
Okay, great. Oh, you've added some. That's even good. I didn't even know that. All right, so let me hit a couple things, then we'll answer just some other general questions. So I've got a lot that I could talk about, but you know, I could go on for 5 hours on this. All right, so Superman shots. We've all seen that type of thing where you see his arms out in front of the camera, but we're moving on a background. So let me find all right, let me go to Act 4. Let's see, where is that? Act 4, Scene 24. Where is that? Here we go. All right, so let's say that we want to do kind of a Superman shot flying in towards this crowd. I don't want to take the time right now to draw the arms in, but what I can do, here we go. I'll just grab in this PNG of my head. So again, I can bring in photos, adjust it however I want, okay? So I've got my head in here, and let's say that we're going to zoom in on these characters, all right? So do the Superman shot. So again, I'm going to do first and last frame keyframes. I'm going to zoom in. Let's say I want to zoom in to these people over here, okay? So make this shot a little longer. All right, so zoom in. But wait a minute, my face is staying attached to the artwork. So we don't really get a good idea there on the Superman shot. Now, I could animate the head with the layer transform, but it's always going to slide around, and it's time-consuming to do. Well, there's a really quick and easy thing that we can do here. So using the separate layer, not my drawing layers, but the layer drop-down box over on the right-hand side, I can actually make a number of adjustments here on any layer. So in this case, under alignment, I'm gonna pin it to the camera. I can have it face camera or pin it to camera. Facing camera is for 3D, so as you're moving around, but I'm gonna pin it to camera. So that quickly, now it stays perfectly in frame as I'm zooming in. So if you think about riding on an arrow going in towards towards the bullseye, you can just put down a layer and pin it to camera, and all of a sudden you've got this great move that quickly. The other cool thing about using this layers menu is that I can also change what exports to what layer. So for instance, I may have, like here I've got arrows and notes. So any directional arrows I'm going to put onto that layer. And as you notice here on my arrows, my default is that I don't want it to export to a movie. I don't want to see action arrows in a movie. I only want to see them in print. So it'll export to Toon Boom, it'll export to PDF, but it won't export to movie. So I can set up where any layer will or will not export depending on what I'm exporting to. So that's just another really fun, quick thing. Another thing that I really love about the software is tracking changes. So let's say I've delivered this to a client, and then they're going to give me notes, or I send them the file. You know, like if I'm working on something and the director wants to mess with it. So then we'll go through and go to Storyboard, and it's just like in Word, and I'll set auto tracking mode for track changes. So now as I go through, and let's say they want me to, and I'll go to a notes layer, and I like drawing my notes in red so I can also see it very quickly. All right, so I grabbed a red pen, and they say, no, you know, let's do much more narrow eyes, right? Notice what happens down here in my timeline. That panel gets a yellow box around it. That means that I did an adjustment or a change on it. So after I go through all the notes, and let's say we come over here, and they want to add two more gnomes, right? Maybe I'll put one back there, another one back here. That's all I'll do for now, and boom, it shows up with the yellow. So now when I get back to my studio, I'll go through and say, all right, I've got to make a change here, and I've got to make a change there. Here's another cool thing that we can do. So if I go to the panel tab, I can actually also record a note. So let's go here to this one, and let's say the director wants to talk about what's happening in here. So you can just click this little record button, and now I'm recording. All right, so what I want to do is let's make this wall barbed wire on top of it, and let's have people's legs being sliced off as they're working. All right, stop it. I'll test the play.
So what I want to do is...
Great. So that all worked great. I click OK. Over here, it shows one of one audio. So as I go through, notice the box down here shows yellow. So I know there's a note. If I don't see one, I look over. There's an audio note. I hit play.
And now I'm recording. All right. So what I want
to I could draw something, and I can leave audio notes. And you can easily tell where it is because as long as you're using your tracking changes, and I can go through and I can then go ahead and validate them one at a time if I want. So, you know, I'll validate that one. Yep, notice the yellow turned off. And I'll validate that one, hit next. So it's very quick and easy to make these things work. So again, I can probably go on. Oh, transitions. A lot of people always ask about transitions. So I'm going to turn off track changes. Notice there's a check mark next to it, so I'm not going to track this anymore. I don't need to right now. But let's say I want to do a transition besides a cut between these two scenes, right, or these two shots. So this is my transition icon. I drag this down to the panel beforehand. Oh, no, don't drag it. Just click on it. That's right. So that quickly, now I've got a cross dissolve. Now I've got other options. I can, if I double click on it, now it's got a line on there. So now it's a wipe. I can click on it again. Now it becomes a radial transition. I can click on it again. It'll wipe the opposite direction. And then it goes back to cross dissolve. So generally you're not going to need anything more than that anyway. But that quickly, I can drop it right in, and I can adjust how long just by dragging on the side on the end of it. I can click on exactly how long that transition is going to be. And it'll also play in real time when I hit the play button. Whew! All right. I know we're way over on time, but any other major questions we should answer?
I think I confirmed that the annotation, of course, all your annotation layers are exportable in your PDF. But when you're exporting it as a movie, will it preserve the annotation layer?
What annotation layer? What do you mean?
I guess it's the notes. You have a notes layer, correct?
Oh, I have a notes layer. I put that on myself, and it just depends on, in this case, I have it set to no, it won't, because I don't want it to. Because if I'm writing notes on there, I don't want it to show, but I can. I can just click right there, and now it will. I mean, it's that fast and easy. Here's a cool little thing. So right now, and I did this just for the demonstration, the default when you open up the software is, whenever you make a new panel, you're going to get a background and an A layer. Okay, that's what's going to come up. Now, like in Photoshop or other, you need to create all of your layers every time you need a drawing. But that's really freaking time consuming. Well, I don't like working that way. Let me find one that's got the layers the way I normally do. Right here. Background, roughs, background 2, tone, ink, foreground, arrows, and notes. All right. And I actually like to always start with my roughs layer because that's what I'm going to draw on. So if I want this to show up every time, all I do is set it up once. And I mean once, not even for a project, just once. And I go under layer, set layer layout as default. So now watch what happens when I make a new panel. All the layers show up exactly the way I've set it. And the roughs layer that I wanted highlighted to start drawing on is automatically highlighted. So once I hit a new one, I can start drawing and I know I'm going to be on the right layer.
You had a question. This goes back to when you had a window with a panel tab open and they were asking if it's part of the workspace you're using or do you have to find it and open it up?
The only thing that's not in the default workspace here is this other layers tab. This is normally, this one over here on the right-hand side is normally not there, but all you do is go under Windows to Layers, and it'll show up for you.
But of course, panel,
storyboard, still properties, and library are automatically there.
And you can add them or subtract them, right, because that's all customizable.
It is fully customizable. I can just grab it and drag it wherever I want, that easy.
Somebody was asking where the transition button was. I think you showed that was on the left-hand side.
The transition button is up along top. It's right where you can add scenes, panel numbers. It's the one that looks like an hourglass with a plus next to it.
Okay. I'm just running down a list of questions now that we had post. How did you adjust the opacity without right-clicking on the drawing layer? It said you clicked on a slider, they think.
Oh, yeah, because there's different things that you can adjust opacity. So as long as I'm on a layer, right at the top of the layers menu is the opacity, so I can just click and drag and drop that down. Or if I'm drawing, I can adjust, I could just take a color, let's say the blue I want to use, but I don't want solid blue, I want it really transparent. So I can come in here, and now I'm drawing with a really transparent blue. Or I could take it back up to 100% in this exact same blue now looks like that.
We had a couple of business questions now. I'll start from the last one and I'll work my back because I know some people earlier asked about how do you budget for live action? And then there was like by panel, by page, or by week?
I never do it by page. It's either by panel, by day, or by week. On commercials, we'll often do by the panel. But sometimes they just have a certain amount budgeted. As long as I know what I'm making, that's fine. I don't mind doing the day rate, but day rate is based on either 9 or 10 hours, so they're not going to work me for 20 for the same rate. It goes to time and a half after 10, goes to double time after 12. Just state it up front, and you can have a really good day. Or you could do a weekly rate. Generally, long-form projects, if you're on an ongoing TV series or feature film, it's going to be a weekly rate, and that's always based on 5 days. And just make sure that your deal agreement states 5 days. So if they work you a 6 day, that you get paid extra for that 6 day.
That's great. Working back with some questions, Melina asks, what is the exact name of the computer program app that I would need to create in my own projects? I'm a homeschooler in 8th grade. Well, first of all, Melina, we have a student rate, so you could write to us and say you're a student, and we'll give you the pricing for students, which is much, much lower, obviously, than it is for commercial or professionals. The name of the program is Storyboard Pro, and you can always write to us and ask us what kind of technical specifications you need for a computer to run Storyboard Pro as well. Moving on, Dan had asked, can the solid color be selected and removed like a green screen key, or can PNG images be imported as layers with opacity?
Yeah, you can import PNG just like I did with my face. If I go into my library here, this is a PNG, and so obviously the transparency holds. You can see it right there. But this is not set up again. It's not Photoshop, so I cannot bring in a bitmap, select a layer, and delete it. What I can do, however, with a bitmap, I can use my cutter tool here, which is under selection. I can go to cutter, and let's say that I want my eyes transparent. I can just come in here and select it, and I can do that. Or I can use my eraser tool, and I can erase. That looks white, but let's see. So I can erase bitmaps. So I can still adjust bitmaps, but it's not Photoshop. We're not going to be doing manipulation, color manipulation.
Keith was asking just to see the export options for finished board, so I think you could just show that.
Yeah, under file, I can export a number of different ways. The bitmap, I've got options of JPEGs, targets, or Photoshop, and with Photoshop, I can export it out with all the layers. You name it, you place where you want it. Image zoom level is how much of you want to see outside the frame. I usually do between 85 and 90% because I like the export showing what I draw outside the frame. 100% cuts it off right at the border of the panel. And then I can select all of them. Current panels, I can select specific shots, you know, as many or as few as I want. And then the other ones that we do often are movies. And if you're going to do a movie, rather than the QuickTime movie, or hold on, it popped it up on the other screen. Drag this over. I always set it. The default is not this, but you'll have it. Just under settings, go to H.264, and that's an MP4. So that's going to be a much smaller version. And then again, I can export the entire movie or just selected shots or scenes. I can also burn in time code if I want. Normally I don't, but there are times that I will, more for animation than I do for live action. And then for PDF, there's a number of different options. And Toon Boom set us up with a number of vertical and horizontal. And there's also multi-panels. So you can adjust any way you want, and then they're all editable. The defaults are not quite the way I want, so in lynda.com I actually have all things specifically on how to adjust it so that everything will show up as great as possible. But it's once you set up once, you don't have to set up again. So I actually have like one client, Blue Moon, that has a very specific way they wanted it. So I edited everything for it, and I just named new version for them. So whenever I'm doing a job for them, I export directly exactly as the way they want. So yeah, it's super quick and easy.
Ben was asking, again, a business question about, I think right now he's doing just sending his clients storyboards, but he thought that'd be great to be able to add animatics as a service, but how he would charge for that.
Well, if you're charging by time, it doesn't matter because you're charging for your time. If you're charging by the panel, then you charge separately for the drawing, and then you figure out how you want to charge them for the animatic. Oftentimes, when I'm doing an animatic, if I kind of have an idea of the amount of time, I might just charge them, here's an overall rate for this spot, and just make sure you give yourself a lot of extra time for changes or in your estimation. But more often than not, I charge by time because it's just makes you that much more valuable.
Great. And Natalie, this is actually, and it's just a philosophical question, I think. How do you feel about being a storyboard artist versus a board artist producing animatics? Do you feel like you can lose key story points?
No, I'm actually better as a story artist because I'm doing these real-time animatics. It allows me to see in an instant if the shots are really working or not. I prefer doing it. I want to be doing animatics. It's a much more interesting process. I mean, I'm still doing all the same drawings, but now they're coming to life in a way that I never had the opportunity to do real time before. So for me, it's a plus, and it's something else extra that I can deliver to my clients. It's something extra that I can charge for. There's literally no negatives. And, you know, I hear people online bitching and moaning about it. And I have no freaking idea what they're talking about. This makes us better. We're better. We're faster. The only people who really should be complaining are editors, and they shouldn't even be complaining. Their rules, union rules have to change because the software has changed. I actually wrote a big article in AWN about it last year, which I forward to people all the time.
You know, interesting about, I was in an industry event hearing some people at Nelvana specifically who eliminated the editor position, you know, dividing the storyboard from the Leica, and they've combined that all into one function. But the great news for the editors was that the editors became assistant directors, and by doing that, they were actually more empowered to be more creative and have more control over the story. It's what they actually call upskilling. So it's actually, I think what you're saying, Mark, and what you can see how Storyboard Pro is changing the industry is that it's actually allowing animator or well, storyboard artists slash assistant directors slash directors all to be more creative and have more control over their storyboards and their animatics. It's really game-changing.
Yeah, it does that, and it does a lot more, too. And I'm not against editors, because not every board artist is going to be a good editor, and no one is saying you should be. I'm just saying you're going to be a better story artist by being able to lay this out. But a good editor will take them less than 5 minutes to understand how to edit in the software. So the way it should be working is as the board artist finishes a sequence, they send it to the editor. The editor works in this software to change the timings and adjust it however they feel it's going to work best. And if they've got ideas on things, they could say, you know what, in between here, I think we should add another shot. And then they can just come in and they can say, let me grab a brush here. They can say, add close-up, right? They're not going to be doing the drawing. But then you as the artist, when you get the master file back, you go through, especially if they did the track changes, you'll know where to look. Everyone's still working on the same file. The editor is still doing what they're doing. The artist is still doing what they're doing. And everyone benefits, and it's faster. And you don't get this clusterfuck that you often get in production when you're trying to use multiple programs. That happens all the time. I mean, I was working on a project, on a feature, and the editor would refuse to work in the software, and it was a major problem. The next one I worked on, the editor said, sure, I'll give it a shot. Within a couple minutes, I had him up and going on it. The difference in the way production flowed was night and day.
By the way, just an interesting note, one of our tech support people just answered one of the questions about bitmap opacity, and he said you can actually change bitmap opacity by right-clicking and choosing change layer opacity.
Well, I can also just do it this way. I mean, I can adjust.
Yeah. I guess I don't, but yeah, so there you go. Just in case that wasn't clear away. Yep. It's nice to see some of our own team members actually joining our sessions here too. The webinar, by the way, for all the people who have asked and for those who haven't asked, if you go to toonboom.com/webinars, you'll be able to see upcoming webinars, but you'll also be able to download the recordings of previous webinars, including this one and the earlier one that Mark did on animation. And of course, we have one coming up soon on storyboards for games. We're going
to
work through these.
I'd like to show real quick, Philip.
Uh-huh.
This I don't know how smoothly this will play here online because we have so many people on, but in the replay it will. This is a quick. This is one of the boards that you saw here. This is a comparison on what my boards and animatic looked like edited to the finished piece, and the director said we could use this. So, check this out. Again, the boards don't need to be real tight in live action. They're rough. They actually prefer it to be rough.
Be the first to visit Orlando this May or June to beat the summer rush and pack more into your vacation. More new rides and attractions, more Orlando favorites, more value than ever. Go to visitorlando.com/work.
So, you know, this is an example of I did an original voice track just for my own timing, and then they redid it, obviously, but with my voice and the timing where I was able to get it, and you could see how every shot is exactly what the director wanted. And directors, live action directors, generally don't want a huge amount of detail because, especially in commercials, the agency would look at it, well, where is this thing that's in the storyboard? They don't want the kind of detail where the agency is going to start picking it apart. They just want to show what they're going to be shooting and then give them the flexibility of making whatever changes or adjustments that they want.
Mark, we're going to have to sign off and say thank you to everybody. Just one quick thing that it was also came up with the storyboards versus animatics question or debate, if you like, even. Kelly was saying that the reason people don't like doing animatics is it does not reflect actual animation timing. But again, I'm sure you'll agree, and I heard this again last night from people who are doing TV and film, is that Oh, have we logged off? Is everybody still there? Is that you can actually do timed animatics. So you can actually tell the director, hey, guess what? Your commercial or your episode is overtime. So you can do timed animatics.
Oh,
correct,
absolutely.
Right?
Yeah. I mean, I do that. That's how I, you know, oftentimes I'll tell a director, you know, it's like, this is 35-second read, and you see how it works. So, but the thing is, generally, you're not worried by the second, and it's only on commercials. You just see if the shot sequence is working or not that you've never had the ability to see before.
Agreed. So, look, I guess if anybody has any questions once the session is over, feel free to write us. My email is philip1lphilip@toonboom.com. You have Mark's contact information. You can find more great great tutorials at lynda.com, both for Mark's stuff. And, of course, you can always come to toonboom.com. We have amazing video tutorials, documents. We have user groups. We have a community section. We have a live blog. So there's a lot of ways to interface with us at Toon Boom, with our tech support people. So don't be shy. Anything comes up, anything you need, please feel free to contact us.
And this will be replaying for them in, what, a day or so?
I think so. If you just go to toonboom.com/webinars, as I said, you'll be able to find links to I think download or replay, or yeah, you're right, not download, but replay the webinar.
Right.
So thank you very much, Mark. I mean, I have to tell you, even though I spend every day looking and talking to people about the software, every time I work with you, I learn something new or a few new things. I hope everybody who joined us feels the same way. And thanks so much for doing such a great presentation. And thank you to everybody for joining us.
Yeah, thanks, everyone. Glad you could hang in there.